So in the triangles of neck, we discussed about submandibular triangle and submental triangle in previous classes, isn't it? So this one is sternocleidomastoid muscle and dividing the neck into an anterior compartment and a posterior compartment. And again, this bone is hyoid bone. Comes here, important bone, and to the hyoid bone attaches the posterior belly of digastric and posterior and the anterior belly. So in between anterior and posterior belly comes a submandibular or digastric triangle, and lateral to the posterior belly. So this space, okay, the posterior belly of digastric, and this is omohyoid. It has got a superior belly and an inferior belly. So between the superior belly of omohyoid, digastric posterior belly and sternocleidomastoid comes the carotid triangle. Okay, so that is the third triangle. The carotid triangle. So what are the boundaries of this carotid triangle? Boundaries. So in boundaries, we have the digastric posterior belly, superior belly of omohyoid and also sternocleidomastoid. So this is a scalene triangle. That means all the three sides are not equal. Okay, it is a scalene triangle also. And laterally, it forms the skin, the subcutaneous tissue, then platysma muscle, then also the inversing layer of deep fascia forms a lateral wall, and the floor is formed by which of the muscles? It is easy to remember. Here comes the thyroid cartilage. Okay, so from the thyroid to the hyoid, the one muscle is thyrohyoid muscle. Okay, so thyrohyoid muscle forms one floor, thyrohyoid muscle. And here comes the tongue. So from here to here forms the hyoglossus. Okay. This hyoid bone is an important landmark coming there. So hyoglossus, and also there are two constrictors. They are the inferior pharyngeal constrictor and also the middle pharyngeal constrictor. You can remember that it is also forming the floor of submandibular triangle. Okay. So the inferior and so all this forms the floor. Okay, so that forms the boundaries. Easy. And superiorly by anterosuperiorly by posterior belly of digastric, and anteroinferiorly by omohyoid, and posteriorly sternocleidomastoid. Laterally, the skin, subcutaneous tissue, and the inversing layer of deep fascia, and the floor is formed by thyrohyoid, hyoglossus and inferior and middle constrictors of the condense. This carotid triangle, as the name suggests, it includes internal jugular vein, carotid artery, and also two nerves. Okay, so internal jugular vein is there, this one, internal jugular vein, and next one is common carotid artery, dividing into an internal carotid and external carotid. Okay, that is at the level of greater horn of hyoid bone. There are two nerves. What are they? One is hypoglossal nerve. So the hypoglossal nerve comes, it crosses the internal jugular vein and external carotid artery. It goes below the posterior belly of digastric and it goes into submandibular triangle. It was already described along with the contents of submandibular triangle. So this one is hypoglossal nerve. So this forms the third condent, and the fourth one is what is it? One nerve going along with the carotid sheath, and that is an important vagus nerve. Okay. So vagus nerve is coming between this. It goes like this. Okay. So that is vagus. So the contents of carotid triangle are internal jugular vein, common carotid artery dividing into external and internal carotid artery, and also hypoglossal nerve and also the vagus nerve. And there are 5 branches of the external carotid artery are given in the carotid triangle. What are they? Of the external carotid. Here comes the thyroid gland. So superior thyroid artery. Okay. So one is superior thyroid. And this is face. So facial artery. And again, what comes in the oral cavity? Mainly the tongue. So the lingual artery. And you can remember it's going here. So this is occipital area. So the occipital artery. And also you have the pharynx here. So the ascending pharyngeal artery. Okay, so all these 5 branches are given off from the external carotid artery in the carotid triangle. Corresponding veins, that is the superior thyroid vein, facial vein, lingual vein, occipital vein and ascending pharyngeal vein follow these arteries and they drain into internal jugular vein. Okay, so these are the contents. Once more I'll explain. They are the internal jugular vein with the 5 veins coming into the internal jugular vein. Then the common carotid dividing into an internal and external carotid, and external carotid artery gives all these 5 branches in the carotid triangle, and also vagus nerve and also the hypoglossal nerve is seen in the carotid triangle. There is another triangle which is located within the carotid triangle which is called as the Farabius triangle. Okay, what is that? It is an area between this hypoglossal nerve, then internal jugular vein and also the common facial vein. So common facial vein is given off from the internal jugular vein and it goes like this. Okay, so and the area between, the triangular area lying between this hypoglossal as one boundary and the common facial as another boundary and the internal jugular vein. So this triangle is called, okay, so this is Farabius triangle, and that is between the hypoglossal nerve, common facial vein and internal jugular vein. Okay, and this is important in identifying the internal jugular vein in extensive neck dissections. Okay, so and triangle bounded between hypoglossal nerve, common facial vein and internal jugular vein is Farabius triangle. Right? And what is the clinical significance of this carotid triangle? One is that this all the structures, that's the internal jugular vein, the common carotid artery and also the hypoglossal as well as the vagus nerve lie relatively superficial in the neck at this triangle. So when you want surgical exploration of these contents, it is best done in the carotid triangle. And second, the proximal part of internal carotid artery, proximal part of internal carotid artery contains carotid sinus, and this carotid sinus or carotid bulb contains baroreceptors which are very much sensitive to stress reflex caused within the blood vessel, and it is innervated by glossopharyngeal nerve and it regulates the blood pressure and it is called the baroreceptor reflex. In some patients they are very much sensitive to this reflex, and even a pressure within the carotid artery will cause reducing the or lowering of the blood pressure and also hypotension, right? And in that patients the pulse should not be taken on by pressing on the carotid. Another term, that is carotid body. Okay, It is a small ovoid mass, carotid body, which is situated on the medial surface or the deep wall of common carotid at the junction of internal carotid, and it contains, this carotid body contains chemoreceptors which are very much sensitive to low levels of oxygen in the blood. So when the saturation of oxygen is reduced, they are stimulated and innervated by both 9th and 10th nerve. They get stimulated and increases respiratory rate and also pulse rate. So this carotid sinus and carotid body, and also this you should know the baroreceptor reflex, which regulates blood pressure on stretching the carotid artery. Okay, so these are the content. This is all about carotid triangle, and I told about the boundary between the posterior belly of digastric, superior belly of homohyoid, and the sternocleidomastoid, and the floor is formed by the muscles. They are the thylohyoid and also hyoglossus and the inferior and middle pharyngeal constrictors. And contents are very important again. They are the internal jugular vein, common carotid artery dividing into internal and external carotid artery with the 5 branches of external carotid artery given off in the triangle, and also hypoglossal nerve and vagus nerve. Right, and this, there is another triangle located within this, and the clinical significance is one, the important structures are superficial in the neck in this triangle, and also the carotid sinus and also the carotid body, right?